A common question we're asked by clients wanting to use a camera or conference prompting system for the first time is to explain how the system works and what are the basic building blocks. First of all, let's understand the basic principles. A teleprompter is a display device that prompts the person speaking with an electronic visual text or image of the speech or script. The words on the screen are reflected into the eyes of the presenter using a sheet of semi-silvered glass. Light from the performer passes through the front side of the glass into the lens, while a shroud surrounds the lens and the back side of the glass, preventing unwanted light from entering. The screen the presenter reads from is called a head-up display, as they don't need to look down to read the script. They appear to have memorized the speech or to be speaking spontaneously, and so can maintain eye contact with the audience, making what they're saying that much more credible. There are two main areas in which prompting is used. Firstly, in TV, where the prompting device is rigged in front of the camera. This isn't limited to broadcast TV, and with cost-effective prompters now available, it's a very viable option for productions in corporate and business TV, education, webcasting, and streamed online delivery. Secondly, is the presenter, events, and public speaking market, where the prompter is either on static or motorized poles, generally on stage next to the lectern, using a conference glass head-up system. The head-up display is generally fed via a BNC with a composite video signal, as you can distribute that further and more easily than, say, HDMI or VGA cables, which can also be used. These are from the prompting source, which is usually a laptop with prompting software running on it. SDI prompting signals are appearing more often now, as studios are generally digital, so a VGA to SDI converter would be required in this case. And we believe into the future, much of this will be replaced with IP technology, which could also provide a remote production workflow. So, a simple prompting system is composed of a computer, that could be a PC or a tablet, a signal, converter and distributor to get the signals across, and at least one head-up display. And finally, and one could argue the most important ingredient, a fully trained operator who rigs, de-rigs, the kit, edits and drives the script for the presenter. If you'd like to find out more, just give us a call or drop us a line or look on our website at www.portaprompt.co.uk.
Frame up two.
Let's go to Brian Fantana.
Give me a tighter one on two.
Live on the scene with a Channel 4 News exclusive. Brian?
And to watch. The mood is tense. I have been on some serious reports, but nothing quite like this. Ching King is inside right now. I tried to get an interview with him, but they said, nope, you can't do that. He's a live bear. He will literally rip your face off.
Hey, you're making me look stupid. Get out here, panda jerk.
Great story. Compelling and rich. Well, that's going to do it for all of us here at Channel 4 News. You stay classy, San Diego. I'm Ron Burgundy.
Damn it! Who typed a question mark on the teleprompter? For the last time, anything you put on that prompter, Burgundy will read.
I have some information that you can choose to use or not use. Up to you. Ron Burgundy will read anything that is put on that teleprompter. And when I say anything, I mean anything.
Arnold Q1.
After the photo mat was destroyed, the bear scampered back into the woods.
Apparently, he wasn't too happy with his color prints.
From the entire Channel 4 News team, I'm Veronica Corningstone.
And I'm Ron Burgundy. Go fuck yourself, San Diego.
What in the name?
No! Nobody talks about my city that way! Ron Burgundy's ass is grass!
Nice work, everyone. Sharp broadcast. Really good. Everyone on the floor as well. Really a lot of hustle. I liked it.
Dump out! Dump out!
Hello, Edward.
Ron, I've got to fire you.
Well, I've got to fire you. Bing, bong, bong. You're fired, Ed.
Do you even know what you just said? Oh! Great Odin's Raven!
Check your panties.
Wait, what did this news anchor just say?
Check your panties.
Apparently, the story was about a slow cooker recall.
And slow cookers are being recalled due to fire and electric shock.
I couldn't warn you before I saw it, and I couldn't warn you, Eric. I'm so sorry.
And the script had a small typo. Apparently, Eric Phillips from News 12 in Richmond, Virginia, didn't catch it fast enough. Instead of panties, the word was supposed to be pantries.
I think that was supposed to be pantries.
As his colleague put it on Twitter, one letter makes all the difference. Yes, this was read on air. Eric admitted online he was embarrassed by his slip-up. Can you say,
I'm Ron Burgundy?
For InsideEdition.com, I'm Lee Sheps.
Live from ABC7, this is Eyewitness News.
Let's take a live look outside on this Wednesday. This is our camera, LAX, at February 8th. Good morning, everybody. Labor Day. I'm Leslie Sykes.
I'm thinking that date was wrong.
What was that?
I think it's off by a few days. February 8th.
Is that what I said?
Yeah, and it ain't Wednesday either.
Sure, people were paying
so
attention.
Embarrassing.
Yeah, no, wow. You're good.
I have no idea what I said, okay.
They probably had the year right, so we'll go with
so
that.
No, it said 2012.
February.
You know what? I remember.
Valentine's Day's coming.
I saw 2012 and I said, don't say that. That's wrong.
It felt good, though, right? I'll take 2012 again.
Yeah.
Right. I'm Rob Hazen for Philip Palmer. Bree's in for Garth. Alicia is here.
You ever get the feeling that the news anchors on television are just mindless media parrots repeating the same talking points over and over again? Well, if you haven't, you might after seeing this.
In consumer news, economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take some of the spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year.
Economic factors may take the spring out of the step of the Easter Bunny this year.
I don't know about you, but I'm getting the feeling that economic factors may take some spring out of the Easter Bunny step this year. But seriously, kudos to Conan O'Brien for once again exposing the media repeaters. Look, guys, obviously this is no coincidence. So the question remains, where are all these news stations getting their scripts from? While there are affiliate news services that supply packages and scripts to hundreds of stations around the country, stations then have their anchors read the canned story with the generic script. Now, you might look at this and say, it's just indicative of how lazy local news can be. But consider the implications of this kind of reporting for one second. Say it wasn't an Easter bunny, and rather the story being mindlessly regurgitated was about a virus, a terrorist attack, or a report on war casualty counts. The bottom line is that people who watch the news tend to trust this information, information that then influences their perception and decisions. So for these anchors to ask no questions, do no fact-checking, and hold no differing interpretation of the news they're delivering is not only absurd, it's downright dangerous.
What if the reality you found was false? A carefully constructed narrative by unseen special interests designed to manipulate your opinion.
I've been a journalist for about 25 years, and I was educated to lie, to betray, and not to tell the truth to the public. There is nobody coming to you and say, well, we are the Central Intelligence Agency, would you like to work for us? No, But this is not the case how it happens. What they do, these transatlantic organizations, is they invite you. They invite you for seeing the United States. They pay all your expenses and everything. So you are bribed. You get more and more corrupt because they make you good contacts. You won't know that those good contacts are, let's say, non-official or officially people working for Central Intelligence Agency or other American agencies. So you make friends. You think they are friends and you cooperate with them. They ask you, well, could you do me this favor? Could you do me that favor? So your brain more and more is brainwashed through these guys. And your question was, is this only the case with German journalists? No, I think it is especially the case with British journalists, because they have a much closer relationship. It is especially the case with Israelis, of course, with French journalists. There is many countries in the Arab world, like Jordan, for example.
A couple of years ago, CBS News asked me to look into a story about a study coming out from the nonprofit National Sleep Foundation. Supposedly, this press release coming out said, the study concluded we are a nation with an epidemic of sleeplessness and we don't even know it, and we should all go ask our doctors about it. A couple of things struck me about that. First, I recognized the phrase ask your doctor as a catchphrase promoted by the pharmaceutical industry. They know that if they can get your foot through the door of the doctor's office to mention a malady, you're very likely to be prescribed the latest drug that's marketed. Second, I wondered how serious an epidemic of sleeplessness could really be if we don't even know that we have it. Right? It didn't take long for me to do a little research and discover that the National Sleep Foundation nonprofit and the study, which was actually a survey, not a study, were sponsored in part by a new drug that was about to be launched onto the market called Lunesta, a sleeping pill. I reported the study as CBS News asked, but of course I disclosed the sponsorship behind the nonprofit and the survey so that viewers could weigh the information accordingly. All the other news media reported the same survey directly off the press release as written without digging past the superficial. It later became an example written up in the Columbia Journalism Review, which quite accurately reported that only we at CBS News had bothered to do a little bit of research and disclose the conflict of interest behind this widely reported survey. Special interests have unlimited time and money to figure out new ways to spin us while cloaking their role. Surreptitious astroturf methods are now more important to these interests than traditional lobbying of Congress. There's an entire industry built around it in Washington. What is astroturf? It's a perversion of grassroots, as in fake grassroots. AstroTurf is when political, corporate, or other special interests disguise themselves and publish blogs, start Facebook and Twitter accounts, publish ads, letters to the editor, or simply post comments online to try to fool you into thinking an independent or grassroots movement is speaking. The whole point of AstroTurf is to try to give the impression there's widespread support for or against an agenda when there's not. AstroTurf seeks to manipulate you into changing your opinion by making you feel as if you're an outlier when you're not. One example is the Washington Redskins name. Without taking a position on the controversy, if you simply were looking at news media coverage over the course of the past year or looking at social media, you'd probably have to conclude that most Americans find that name offensive and think it ought to be changed. But what if I told you 71% of Americans say the name should not be changed? That's more than two-thirds. AstroTurfers seek to controversialize those who disagree with them. They attack news organizations that publish stories they don't like, whistleblowers who tell the truth, politicians who dare to ask the tough questions, and journalists who have the audacity to report on all of it.
Sometimes the intelligence agencies, they come to your office and want you to write an article. The German Foreign Intelligence, Bundesnachrichtendienst, they wanted me to write an article about Libya and about Colonel Muammar Gaddafi. They gave me all these secret informations and they just wanted me to write, to sign the article with my name. I did that. It was a story that was printed worldwide 2 days later. But I had no information on that. It was the intelligence agency. So do you really think that this is journalism? Intelligence agencies writing articles?
This is an American president. Just add puppet, then vote and repeat every 4 years.
Whoa. The president's troubles with the teleprompter, well, they don't seem just to go away. Today, a problem brought his remarks on the economy to a crashing halt. Take a listen.
To pull our economy.
Oh, goodness.
Sorry about that, guys. To pull our economy back from the brink, including the largest and most sweeping economic recovery plan in our nation's history. If we had not taken that step, our cities would be in an even deeper hole.
Can you say technical difficulty? We've all had that happen, right, Wolf?
Yeah, that's why, you know what, you know, the president needs, I don't know if he hasn't, he always needs the script.
Yes.
In his hands when or in front of
like
him.
Like what we have right
That's
here.
Right. In case that teleprompter crashes as it just did, he's got a backup. He's got another one on the right side. But if the one on the left side goes down, if both of them goes down, this is what he needs. He needs a little script there in front of
like
him.
Like a true professional, Wolf.
Yeah, that's the advice we can give him as people who've dealt with teleprompters over the years. Very often they just don't work.
It appears that President Obama's teleprompter froze and caused him to panic when he was trying to trash Donald Trump while he was stumping for Hillary Clinton. Have a look.
If we turn against each other based on divisions of race or religion, if we fall for, you know, a bunch of okie doke.
Okie doke.
Just the because it sounds funny or
he is absolutely lost without his teleprompter. Please continue, President Obama.
Sir, provocative. Then we're not going to build on the progress that we've started.
Oh, there it goes. The glitch ended. Just had a little, the computer froze there for a few seconds, just causing him to panic.
I just wanted to say that, and it's always a lot of fun when you come up and the people don't have the teleprompter working, but that's okay. Lucky I brought some notes. Everything that is broken today can be fixed, and every failure can be turned into a truly great success. Just look at the way I just melded into the teleprompter that just went off. Who else could have pulled that off, okay? Who else? What happened with the teleprompter, man? Hey, he's a little late, right? Oh, well. I had nothing to do with it.
Read my lips. No new taxes. I will keep America moving forward, always forward, for a better America, for an endless, enduring dream and 1,000 points of light. This is my mission, and I will complete it.
We must protect the position of the American dollar as a pillar of monetary stability around the world. In the past 7 years, there's been an average of one international monetary crisis every year. Now, who gains from these crises? Not the working man, not the investor, not the real producers of wealth. The gainers are the international money speculators. Because they thrive on crises, they help to create them. In recent weeks, the speculators have been waging an all-out war on the American dollar. The strength of a nation's currency is based on the strength of that nation's economy. And the American economy is by far the strongest in the world. Accordingly, I have directed the Secretary of the Treasury to take the action necessary to defend the dollar against the speculators. I have directed Secretary Connally to suspend temporarily the convertibility of the dollar into gold or other reserve assets, except in amounts and conditions determined to be in the interest of monetary stability and in the best interest of the United States. Now, what does this action, which is very technical, what does it mean for you? Let me lay to rest the bugaboo of what is called devaluation. If you want to buy a foreign car or take a trip abroad, market conditions may cause your dollar to buy slightly less. But if you are among the overwhelming majority of Americans who buy American-made products in America, your dollar will be worth just as much tomorrow as it is today. The effect of this action, in other words, will be to stabilize the dollar. Now, this action will not win us any friends among the international money traders. But our primary concern is with the American workers and with fair competition around the world. To our friends abroad, including the many responsible members of the international banking community who are dedicated to stability and the flow of trade, I give this assurance. The United States has always been and will continue to be a forward-looking and trustworthy trading partner. In full cooperation with the International Monetary Fund and those who trade with us, we will press for the necessary reforms to set up an urgently needed new international monetary system. Stability and equal treatment is in everybody's best interest. I am determined that the American dollar must never again be a hostage in the hands of international speculators.
Since this is the last speech that I will give as president, I think it's fitting to leave one final thought, an observation about a country which I love. It was stated best in a letter I received not long ago. A man wrote me and said, "You can go to live in France, but you cannot become a Frenchman. You can go to live in Germany or Turkey or Japan, but you cannot become a German, a Turk, or Japanese. But anyone from any corner of the earth can come to live in America and become an American." Yes, the torch of Lady Liberty symbolizes our freedom and represents our heritage, the compact with our parents, our grandparents, and our ancestors. It is that lady who gives us our great and special place in the world. For it's the great life force of each generation of new Americans that guarantees that America's triumph shall continue unsurpassed into the next century and beyond. Other countries may seek to compete with us, but in one vital area, as a beacon of freedom and opportunity that draws the people of the world, no country on earth comes close. This, I believe, is one of the most important sources of America's greatness. We lead the world because, unique among nations, we draw our people, our strength, from every country and every corner of the world. And by doing so, we continuously renew and enrich our nation. While other countries cling to the stale past, here in America, we breathe life into dreams, we create the future, and the world follows us into tomorrow. Thanks to each wave of new arrivals to this land of opportunity, we're a nation forever young, forever bursting with energy and new ideas, and always on the cutting edge, always leading the world to the next frontier. This quality is vital to our future as a nation. If we ever closed the door to new Americans, our leadership in the world would soon be lost. A number of years ago, an American student traveling in Europe took an East German ship across the Baltic Sea. One of the ship's crew members from East Germany, a man in his 60s, struck up a conversation with the American student. After a while, the student asked the man how he had learned such good English, and the man explained that he had once lived in America. He said that for over a year he'd worked as a farmer in Oklahoma and California, that he'd planted tomatoes and picked ripe melons. It was, the man said, the happiest time of his life. Well, the student, who'd seen the awful conditions behind the Iron Curtain, blurted out the question, "Well, why did you ever leave?" "I had to," he said. "The war ended." The man had been in America as a German prisoner of war. Now, I don't tell this story to make the case for former POWs. Instead, I tell this story just to remind you of the magical, intoxicating power of America. We may sometimes forget it, but others do not. even a man from a country at war with the United States, while held here as a prisoner, could fall in love with us. Those who become American citizens love this country even more. And that's why the Statue of Liberty lifts her lamp to welcome them to the Golden Door. It is bold men and women yearning for freedom and opportunity who leave their homelands and come to a new country to start their lives over. They believe in the American dream, and over they make it come true for themselves, for their children, and for others. They give more than they receive, they labor and succeed, and often they are entrepreneurs. But their greatest contribution is more than economic, because they understand in a special way how glorious it is to be an American. They renew our pride and gratitude in the United States of America, the greatest, freest nation in the world, the last best hope of man on earth.
If you've retired, you don't have anything to worry about. It's the third time I've said that. I'll probably say it three more times. See, in my line of work, you got to keep repeating things over and over and over again for the truth to sink in, to kind of catapult the propaganda.